Hello, everybody. My name is Rigas Tsiakiris, and I will be the moderator of this new event with the theme Agroforestry and Ancient Forest Protection. This webinar will take place in English, but there is also a translation in German. Unfortunately, the moderator, Anna, has not the opportunity to do this because she's a little bit ill. So I will make the moderation and I will give the talk to Dagmar, who will say some small introductory talk about the topic, and then we will commence with the other speakers. So, Dagmar, would you say some words to us?
Many thanks, Rigas, Efferistopoli, einen wunderschönen guten Abend, späten Nachmittag, von wo immer Sie, ihr uns zuschaut und zuhört. Mein Name ist Dagmar Tutschek. Ich bin die Obfrau von FREDA, der Grünen Zukunftsakademie. Das ist die Parteiakademie der Grünen in Österreich. Ich darf euch heute sehr herzlich begrüßen, nicht nur im Namen der FREDA, sondern auch der Green European Foundation, gemeinsam mit unseren griechischen Kooperationspartnerinnen haben wir diese Veranstaltung heute organisiert. Diese Veranstaltung ist eingebettet in ein größeres mehrjähriges Projekt. Jeff liegt es sehr am Herzen, solche transnationalen Projekte zu unterstützen und voranzubringen. Der große Überbegriff für dieses Projekt lautet Deforestation und Climate Change. Und das heutige Thema ist sehr spezifisch abgestimmt auf die Situation in Griechenland. Wir hatten vor einigen Monaten einen sehr spannenden Auftakt zusammen mit Rumänien, wo es in erster Linie darum ging, was dort, ich sage es jetzt ganz prononciert auf Deutsch, Grauslichkeiten passieren, illegale Abholzungen in den letzten Urwäldern Europas. Und wir haben uns auch angeschaut, welche Rolle hier unrühmlicherweise auch Firmen aus Österreich spielen. Unser nächster Fokus ist jetzt in Griechenland, wo sich unsere Kolleginnen sehr intensiv Gedanken gemacht haben, wie man eine nachhaltige Forstwirtschaft mit einer guten kleinräumigen Landwirtschaft verbinden kann. Darüber hören wir heute viel und ich freue mich sehr, dass wir auch einen Europaparlamentarier hier haben, der einen der Inputs halten wird. Der nächste Schritt in unserem Projekt wird dann sein, Best Practice Beispiele wieder zurück nach Österreich, und ich freue mich sehr, möglichst viele von euch dann zu uns einladen zu dürfen. Wir setzen schon sehr darauf, dass im Herbst das Reisen wieder möglichst frei erlaubt sein wird und euch bei uns begrüßen zu dürfen. Und jetzt darf ich an Adrian übergeben, Adrian Todt, mein Kollege von der Green European Foundation. Er wird euch auch noch ein paar ganz, ganz nützliche Hinweise für den Ablauf dieser Konferenz heute geben. Vielen Dank, Adrian, und uns allen eine gute und spannende Diskussion.
Thank you very much, Dagmar. Hello, everybody. My name is Adrian. I'm from the Green European Foundation, one of the three project coordinators here. As Dagmar mentioned, this is a two-year project, the second year. Last year, we started off with indeed focusing on deforestation in Romania. And this year, together with our Austrian partners, FREDA and the Greek Green Institute, we will be focusing on agroforestry and ancient forest protection. There is already a large interest in this topic and over 120 participants signed up. I would like to start off with a few technicalities before we dive into the speeches. Indeed, on your right-hand side, this event is in English as well as simultaneous translation in German. Chat box is announced already, and you can put your questions there for all the speakers. And now I would like to hand it over to Rigas, our Greek colleague, who will introduce the speakers.
Thank you very much, Adrian. This is a very unique combination of forces, let's say, the North European countries with the intensity of the forest production of focusing especially on timber, and the South European countries, which are in not so wealthy countries, but their forestry sector is also very small but very unique considering biodiversity issues. So I will start my introduction on I am a forest ecologist, and I'm a member of the scientific committee of the Green Institute Greece, and we started this small idea of presenting some best practice examples that are not only important for our country but could have also applicable ideas in the whole European continent. Therefore, I will present also the results of our three events, which I will say in depth in a few minutes, what has been done by our institution so far. So the general idea behind this is that the most threatened landscapes, forest landscapes in the EU are the ancient forests. But ancient forests are not always in the remote areas. Sometimes they are nearby us. And this is especially the issue in forest landscapes in the south of Europe, where many areas and many ancient trees are combined with landscapes that we say these are agroforestry landscapes that are preserved through the low intensity farming activities. Those ancient trees and ancient forests sometimes are, we say that they are wood pastures or are combined agricultural activities with forest activities. We say that these are landscape multifunctional landscapes, and that these landscapes are very resilient in climate change, of course, because they have persisted for thousands of years. On the other hand, these landscapes are the most threatened ones. These landscapes are very are not anymore economically viable, and these are deserted, abandoned, and especially in the Mediterranean region, when we abandon this landscape, flammable new shrublands and forests are coming up because this biomass is not taken either by grazing animals, not by cleaning up this vegetation, by plowing the fields, etc. But also, so they are abandoned and they are threatened by mega fires, which are the result of course of climate change. On the other hand, intensification of land use, like you said, in Austria or Ukraine, are also threatening this ancient forest because of the intensification of land use. So we have this dipolo, this abandonment on the one side and intensification of land use in the other. So the other thing is that the EU launched a very ambitious goal in of planting 3 billion trees until 2030 in order to tackle the problem with the emissions of CO2, and that money could be taken from the private sector in order to compensate a little bit the problems that industries and other activities could damage the climate. So this idea is very attractive also for the private sector, but do we need only to reforest areas, or could we also combine forces in order to implement other strategic issues for the policy of EU, like a Biodiversity Act, also like the 17 Goals of Sustainable Development, or the need for tackling the desertification, or the problem of creating new jobs after the COVID-19 era? So our idea as a Green Institute, it was a retro innovative idea launching an initiative which we name as reproductive reforestation. What is a reproductive reforestation? Is an initiative that combines the reforestation, so creating new forest in the areas where forest existed, afforestation, which is creating a forest in areas that doesn't exist, a forest never exists, and planting trees. So these three pylons of planting, let's say, trees could be done in a way that could create multifunctional forest, but also preserving ancient landscape, protecting agroforestry system, and bringing more, let's say, products in the market, creating more jobs, and in the same time protecting the ancient forest from the wood demand. We made therefore three events. The three events had to do with what is productive reforestation, what is this idea, and that are about the desertification and the new fund, which is about the resilience and the recovery fund. And we asked, we invited some speakers, and we combine all this current scientific knowledge of these invited speakers, which they were from academies, institutions, NGOs, etc. And we produced this book that I will present you in a minute, which will be, which we wanted to be a book of guidelines for the policymakers also and for the wider public. So our book is, I will share my screen now. And this is our book. If you see it, I don't know. Do you see my screen now?
Yes.
All right. The title is Productive Reforestation for Living Rural Landscapes. And the topic is how we can create jobs and reviving agroforestry systems that sustained many, many years, thousands of years, for livestock farming, also for agriculture, for beekeeping, and for the biodiversity, while tackling desertification, erosion, and mitigating the effects of climate change. This is the product of also a scientific committee that we are working in as a team for producing this in a very short period, in 2 months only. And this is our small logo, which is about, you know, the bee and the goat and the ancient tree. And this is the book of the proceedings. So these are the our invited speakers, are 20 people. And clicking in this icon, you can find also the presentation of each speaker. So this is a characteristic example of ancient forest in Greece, open wood pasture in Xeromero area. Anastasia Bandera will speak about this special issue. And here Ilias Yanniris, the president of our institution, said about a small greeting about what is the purpose of our goal. So I also make an introduction saying about these unique landscapes and how we can tackle biodiversity crisis and global climate change problems with the reforestations, and how we can create jobs and how we can involve local people in that. So this I will escape now and to show you the how. Okay, sorry. Do you see again? This is the way we present our work. This is the invitation card of the first event. And here was the Majanas, the first talk. It was by him and explained what is agroforestry and this mixture of land uses and creating new but also preserving the old ones. Also, Panagiotis Anatoudis said about the saving of local varieties and how we can exchange seeds, and how this he held one of the biggest seed festivals of the world, and how important it is to preserve the Asian varieties. Whereas Sofia Gounaris said about the beekeeping and the importance of beekeeping in the forest landscapes. The beekeeping is crucial for preserving the biodiversity there. As also Nikisianis said about invite us to see these important, hugely abandoned landscapes of the mountains of Greece, where ancient races of fruit trees can be a potential for exploitation, and they can create, like Maloupa said here, new clones of berries and trees that are adapted in a local environment, could be resilient in climate change, and could produce innovative products, and can be used also for reforestation, afforestation, and planting. The second event, it was about desertification. You see characteristic example of desertification in the islands. And we had Dr. Yasoglou. Yasoglou is one of the very famous in Greece professors, because he was the first to invent the National Commission of Against Desertification. He pointed out how important it is to have action plan in the country and also in Greece, while Panagiotis Panagos said about the conclusions of the European Court, and he said about the importance of having a joint forces about all strategies that have to do with the European policy about the strategy of the climate change strategy, and also to take the desertification issue in account. Also, Christos Tsantilas said about the intensification of land uses, and how you see, as you see here in the agricultural sector, and how this is very, very threatful for the agriculture, for the soil and the productivity in general, while Dr. Kaliva said about the prioritization and how we can use the modern technology to implement the measures we need as fast as possible in most areas. Dr. Parpanastasi said about the rangeland and how they have been deserted, and how they can be used sustainably, while Yannis Kazoglou said about the local races and how they can be used to tackle the problems of sustainable management of rangeland, while Dr. Petanidou said about how we can use these terraces, the stone wall terraces that are in a huge area in islands, how we can treat them as barriers for climate change, and how we can say that these are green infrastructure that have to be preserved and revived. Whereas the last event was about the resilient and the recovery fund, and Dr. Kizos said about the CAP policies and how they can preserve or destroy these ASEAN landscapes, while Dr. Hadjigeorgiou said about the importance of local seed varieties to revive the grasslands, and also the Dr. D'Alesios said about the priorities, how to identify this agroclimatic zoning, and Dr. Petanidou said about the genetic diversity of forest and forest species, and how we have to make nurseries with local varieties of genetic local varieties of wild forest species, while Perry Kourakli said about the national strategy of forest strategy, which has been launched in 2018, and how we can commence with this. And Dr. Kakouros said about the history of the forestry service and how difficult was in this landscape to create these multifunctional landscapes in the past, and how we have to have a new Mediterranean smart forestry Mediterranean forestry in order to tackle the new problems. Lastly, Emilia Drugas said about the importance of identify the globally important agriculture heritage systems and how the new agriculture policy could develop this this point of view and how this tool could be used as to find out new areas and to identify priority actions. Then, lastly, I will give you the chance to read and to see from Jeff's website also the summary and conclusion. We have here a long text that has many many recommendations and actions to be implemented and policy prioritization. And this is, let's say, the combining result of all the issues before. And lastly, you can find everything in the press release, etc., in Greek language, of course, in the last page. That's all from my part, and I hope it was interesting. And now I have to give the speech. I will start. I want to stop sharing and give the talk to our next invite speaker, who is Martin Häusling, MP from the European Parliament. We are very pleased to have him with us, and he will give a talk about the common agriculture policy and the traditional forms of agriculture. I know that he knows this issue very much in depth, because he is also an agriculturalist in the product on biological products, yes, if I am right. So I'm very pleased to hear, and also our participants to hear his point of view on this issue. Thank you very much. So Martin, you have the speech now.
Ja, vielen herzlichen Dank erstmal für die Einladung. In der Tat, ich bin sagen, in meinem vorigen Leben bin ich auch Landwirt gewesen. Den Betrieb machen jetzt meine Söhne weiter. Und wie das sich bei uns in Hessen, ich komme aus der Mitte Deutschlands, gehört, hatten wir nicht nur Landwirtschaft, sondern auch immer ein Stück Forstwirtschaft. Aber da fängt das nämlich schon an, die Problematik gemeinsamer Agrarpolitik und Forstwirtschaft, weil das ist bei uns ganz scharf getrennt. Da gibt es Wald und da gibt es Landwirtschaft. Und da gibt es kaum sozusagen Mischsysteme, die im Grunde genommen ja eigentlich sinnvoll wären. Zurzeit, und das ist meine zweite Agrarreform, die ich im Parlament mache, verhandeln wir über die Verteilung von insgesamt 387 Milliarden Euro für die nächsten 7 Jahre. Und ich sage mal so, die Hoffnung stirbt zuletzt, aber normalerweise ist es so, dass sich eher diese Agrarpolitik orientiert an einem Standardmodell mitteleuropäische Landwirtschaft, Betriebe, die sozusagen keine Mischformen haben, sondern das ist ganz klasse. There is no English translation? Ich hoffe, es geht. Dass sozusagen sich das orientiert eher einer auf Weltmarkt ausgerichteten Landwirtschaft mit immer größerer Produktivität. Nicht mit Kleinbauern beschäftigt man sich relativ wenig. Das ist leider so, sondern ganz im Gegenteil. Wenn ich mir so manche Kollegen im Agrarausschuss anhöre oder auch Länderagrarminister, sind Landwirte, die unter 10 Hektar sind, eher Auslaufmodelle, die Agrarstruktur ja behindern, weil man der Meinung ist, das Ganze müsse alles unheimlich produktiv sein. Und deshalb ist sozusagen schon mal die allgemeine Ausrichtung der gemeinsamen Agrarpolitik auf einen echten falschen Weg. Und dass man dann auch noch Förderung gibt oder in manchen Ländern Förderung geben will, dass Betriebe aufhören, um angeblich einen Generationenwechsel zu erzeugen, zeigt, dass man in vielen Bereichen auf dem Weg ist, diese traditionellen Strukturen, die kleinen Betriebe eher vom Markt wegzudrängen, anstatt ihnen eine entsprechende Möglichkeit zu geben. Und das liegt immer noch daran, in erster Linie, weil das Fördersystem danach ausgerichtet ist, auf die Hektar. Also 60% der Zahlungen, da wird sich auch nicht viel dran ändern, gehen in die Förderung von Hektaren. Hast du viele Hektar, kriegst du viel Geld. Hast du wenig Hektar, kriegst du halt nichts. Ich sage immer spaßhalber, bei uns für den Großbetrieb in Ostdeutschland mit 1000 Hektar, der kann sich am Jahresende von der Förderung der EU einen neuen Schlepper kaufen. Und für die anderen reicht es nicht für den Sprit, für die kleinen Betriebe. Deshalb ist es tatsächlich so, dass wir dringend eine Neuausrichtung bräuchten. Und wir haben auf der anderen Seite letztes Jahr verabschiedet im Europäischen Parlament die Forststrategie. Auch die läuft eigentlich in Richtung produktive, schnell, maschinell erntbare, abzuerntende Wälder für die Holzproduktion. Das orientiert sich auch eher an nordischen Wäldern und gar nicht an traditionellen südeuropäischen Forstwäldern und schon gar nicht an Wäldern, die sagen, an Landschaften, die eine Doppelnutzung haben. Auch da läuft es falsch. Man muss aber zur Entschuldigung sagen, diese Forststrategie ist eine Strategie der Europäischen Union. Forstpolitik als solche ist Sache der Nationalstaaten. Da hat also die Europäische Union relativ wenig mit zu tun. Was wir jetzt bräuchten, und dazu besteht ja durchaus auch die Chance in der neuen GAP, dass wir die Förderung neu ausrichten. Da soll es jetzt ein neues Modell geben, das nicht mehr nur die Hektare zählt, sondern auch das Ergebnis der Förderung. Und dazu gehört Förderung der Biodiversität, Förderung des Klimanutzens. Und deshalb sind jetzt Systeme wie die Agroforestry, jetzt könnt ihr mal das einspeisen, was ich an Folien vorbereitet habe, ist jetzt plötzlich auf der Agenda und eines der vier Maßnahmen, die jetzt gefördert werden sollen in der ersten Säule im Rahmen von dem sogenannten neuen Eco-Schemes. Wenn jetzt die Präsentation käme, wäre es ganz gut. Ich rede mal weiter, weil 30% der Agrarförderung soll jetzt in der ersten Säule anhand von freiwilligen Umweltleistungen passieren. Und eines dieser Modelle, die dann gefördert wird, ist dann auch die Agroforst-Methode. Man muss sagen, in vielen Ländern, wie auch in meinem Land, in Deutschland, ist das eine Methode, die bis vor kurzem überhaupt noch nicht auf der Agenda stand. Man hat sogar das gar nicht gefördert, weil man dann angefangen hat, und das ist ja auch kein Witz, das ist ja tatsächlich so, man hat dann angefangen zu zählen, wie viele Bäume dürfen auf einem Hektar stehen, damit es noch genutzt werden kann als Wiese, oder wie viel müssen denn abgeholzt werden, damit das noch in Agrarförderprogramme passt. Und man hatte die Agroforstlandwirtschaft gar nicht auf dem Schirm. Und das hat man jetzt, Gott sei Dank, will man das ändern, sodass also Agrarforstsysteme im Grunde genommen Bestandteil werden können, weil die Maßnahmen sind ja freiwillig von jedem Mitgliedsland, dass diese Agrarforstlandwirtschaft auch gefördert wird, auch als Schwerpunkt gefördert wird, wenn es das Mitgliedsland anbietet. Wir alle wissen, und das ist ja eben auch deutlich geworden, hat einen hohen Effekt für Biodiversität. Und das Ziel der neuen GAP soll ja auch eine Förderung von Biodiversität sein. Wir wissen alle, dass es eine erhöhte Schutz vor Erosion hat. Wir hatten vor mehreren Jahren in Deutschland viele Tote auf einer Autobahn, weil ein Sandsturm in Deutschland, sagen Sie, Sicht versperrt hat und die Autos ineinander gerast sind, weil man Flächen in der Größenordnung von 100 Hektar am Stück hatte, wo dann der Staub aufgewirbelt wurde. Das kann man vermeiden mit einer vernünftigen Anpflanzung von Forst, von Waldflächen, also oder auch Streifen von Forst und die auch nutzen. Und deshalb ist das ein Punkt, der ganz wichtig ist. Dazu kommt natürlich der Aufbau von Humus, von langfristigen Humus und nicht nur kurzfristigen Humus. Und das Ganze hat natürlich auch was zu tun, dass dadurch durch diese Wurzeln, durch das langfristige Festlegen am Ende auch der Nährstoffkreislauf besser zugänglich wird und der Wasserkreislauf besser ist. Also all diese Geschichten sind eigentlich in der Wissenschaft seit langem bekannt und seit langem auch Bestandteil von vielen Diskussionen. Nur sie haben bisher nie in irgendeinen Fördertatbestand gepasst. Und das müssen wir jetzt dringend ändern. Nächste bitte. Und ich denke, deshalb ist es auch so wichtig, dass man diese Förderung jetzt auch einbringt. Wo viele Bauern halt gerade in Mitteleuropa das kritisch sehen, ist ja gut, wir haben unsere Flächen in den letzten Jahren rationalisiert für große Techniken. Man sieht das mit so Mähdreschern, fährt man halt lieber gerne 100 Hektar am Stück ab, anstatt zwischen Bäumen zu kurven. Das ist richtig, aber es geht auch, wenn man entsprechend guten Willen hat und wenn man eine Förderung danach ausrichtet, dass dann ein Bauer, der diese Förderung auch in Anspruch nimmt, mehr Geld bekommt als jemand, der gar nichts macht. Und deshalb ist es tatsächlich so, dass das ein Riesenschritt nach vorne wäre, um sozusagen auch vor allem was für die Biodiversität und Schutz der Umwelt zu tun. Wie gesagt, Deutschland hat es jetzt in den neuen nationalen Strategieplänen jetzt auch untergebracht, was wir jetzt, glaube ich, in erster Linie mal brauchen, weil wir in vielen Regionen in Europa nicht mehr traditionelle Formen von Agroforst haben, dass wir die Bauern wieder schulen und den Bauern auch die Vorteile des Systems ein Stück weit auch wieder nahe bringen, weil viele Bauern erstmal sehr skeptisch sind. Man hat, und das ist ja wirklich so, in Deutschland hat man das in vielen anderen Ländern auch Flurbereinigung genannt. Das heißt, man hat im vorigen Jahrhundert, in den 70er, 80er Jahren noch Flächen begradigt, hat Bäume und Hecken runtergenommen, damit große Einheiten entstehen. Und jetzt kommt sozusagen dieselbe Verwaltung und sagt, ja, ihr müsst ja wieder Hecken und Bäume pflanzen. Das ist für viele Bauern erstmal nicht nachvollziehbar. Deshalb müssen wir das auch den Bauern nahebringen. Nächste. Und ich denke, dass man auch das verbinden kann, auch in Südeuropa mit Systemen, wo man ganz deutlich sagen kann, da gibt es ja viele Beispiele, die wir in vielen anderen Ländern auch übertragen können. Und das ist, wie gesagt, jetzt, und da bin ich gespannt, wir haben nächste Woche höchstwahrscheinlich die Schlussverhandlungen, ob die Kommission einen Vorschlag macht, der ganz klar das in den Vordergrund stellt, das als Maßnahme auch speziell fördert. Also es geht auch darum, dass jetzt das auch mit einer Anreizkomponente ausgestattet wird und dass die Mitgliedstaaten auch nach diesem neuen Fördermodell dann auch greifen. Und dann kann man auch sozusagen alte Anlagen, wie hier zu sehen mit den Olivenbäumen, die kann man auch tatsächlich erhalten und muss nicht dann darum kämpfen, in welchem Bereich der Förderung das jetzt passt, sondern das kann man ganz gezielt über beide Maßnahmen, erste Säule, zweite Säule in der Agrarförderung auch integrieren. Weiter. Und der Vorteil ist, und wir hatten eine Veranstaltung mit Herrn Timmermans und haben ihm das auch erklärt an dem Punkt, wo man dann auch deutlich gesagt haben, das wäre doch gut, wenn man diese Agrarforstmethoden jetzt implementiert, und die Bauern dafür belohnt, Strategien ein. In die Natura 2000 Strategie, in European Sustainable Development Strategy, ins Klimaprogramm passt es rein, es passt in die Forststrategie. Und das sind alles Geschichten, KORK 1 und 2, ich werde jetzt wenigen was sagen, aber das ist die Entwicklung der ländlichen Räume. Da gab es zwei große Konferenzen. Und deshalb könnte man auch wirklich daraus Modellprojekte gestalten, wo gerade Länder in Südeuropa ein Vorbild sein können. Ich muss selber zugeben, als jemand, der in einer Landschaft lebt, wo das traditionell seit vielen Jahren nicht mehr der Fall ist, wäre es, glaube ich, ganz gut. Man würde das sozusagen aus Griechenland oder auch aus Rumänien übertragen und kann man sagen, die Vorteile, die da deutlich geworden sind in den letzten Jahren, traditionelle Formen von Landwirtschaft, kann man jetzt sozusagen zum Modell entwickeln. Das wäre mal ein echter Shift, das wäre mal echt eine echte Wende in der gemeinsamen Agrarpolitik, weil man wegkäme von diesem Wegrationalisieren, sondern dass plötzlich traditionelle Formen der Landwirtschaft kombiniert mit einer vernünftigen Forstwirtschaft jetzt plötzlich einen Modellcharakter haben für eine andere Form von Landwirtschaft. Timmermans selber hat ja in der Farm-to-Fork-Strategie gesagt, 3 Milliarden Bäume für Europa. Das ist eine gute Idee, aber die sollten wir nicht alle nur im Wald, sagen in der Definition Wald pflanzen, sondern die sollten wir auch in der Agrarlandschaft unterbringen. Und ich freue mich gerade hier, nächste Folie, ich freue mich gerade hier, dass wir tatsächlich dieses Jahr mal kein Wasserproblem haben, sondern dass es dieses Jahr bei uns relativ feucht ist. Aber letztes Jahr um die Zeit hatten wir hier, und das war die dritte Trockenheit hintereinander, Verhältnisse, die hier keiner kannte, wo also wirklich schon das Wachstum Ende Mai aufgehört hat und wir eine Trockenheit hatten, wie sie seit Generationen nicht bekannt war, und das 3 Jahre hintereinander. Das zeigt, dass wir dringend Agrarsysteme anpassen müssen. Und deshalb hoffe ich, das ist nach wie vor ja noch alles offen, deshalb hoffe ich, dass man diese Chance ergreift, sowohl in den Mitgliedsländern, aber auch, dass die Kommission die Chance ergreift, das als Standard zu implementieren, und dass wir auch mal aufhören zu sagen, und das wäre noch ein wichtiger Punkt, diese scharfe Trennung von Wald und Ackerland aufzuheben. Ich weiß, dass es da immer noch viele gibt in den Verwaltungen, die da ein Problem mit haben. Also die österreichischen Kollegen wissen, dass es in Österreich vor ein paar Jahren mal eine Untersuchung gab auf den Almen, dass dann plötzlich jemand kam und hat gesagt, ja, es ist ja schön und gut, das sind ja 30 Hektar, aber da ist ja ein Stein und da steht ein Baum und da ist eine Hecke. Das müssen wir jetzt alles rausrechnen, und dann kriegt er entsprechend weniger Prämie. Das konnte ja dann durch massive Interventionen gestoppt werden. Aber demnächst möchte ich, dass genau wenn da Bäume stehen, wenn da Hecken sind, dass der Landwirt mehr kriegt und nicht weniger kriegt in dem Fördersystem. Und das wäre sozusagen eine Belohnung für die, die diese Agrarsysteme machen oder schon immer gemacht haben. Und wir holen so ein System aus der Nische. Ich kann sagen, man kommt ja jedenfalls früher war das so, als Europaabgeordneter auch ein bisschen durch die Gegend. Ich war mehrmals in Südamerika und habe auf der einen Seite die absolut industrielle Agrarindustrie gesehen mit, ja, alle kennen diese Bilder mit 20 Mähdreschern nebeneinander in einem endlos großen Feld. Ich habe dann aber auch die Kontraste angeschaut, wie indigene Gemeinschaften oder tatsächlich mitten in der argentinischen Pampa ein Demeterbetrieb Agroforstsysteme gemacht hat in einer traditionellen Art und Weise. Und wenn man dann die Erträge vergleicht, auch das gehört zur Wahrheit, dann ernten die Sojabauern 2 Tonnen Soja pro Hektar. Und während man in solchen nachhaltigen Systemen in diesen Agrarlandschaften ein 3-4-faches von dem erntet, weil man Stockwerkanbau betreibt und die Systeme sozusagen viel intensiver, aber auch besser genutzt werden. Auch das muss man, glaube ich, auch vielen, die immer noch von der industriellen Landwirtschaft schwärmen, erklären. Und ich hoffe, deshalb können wir neue Akzente setzen an dem Punkt. Und ich hoffe gerade, wie gesagt, von euch aus Griechenland, aber auch von anderen Ländern, dass diese Impulse auch in andere Länder getragen werden, dass man sagt, so sieht vielleicht eine nachhaltige Landwirtschaft in Zukunft aus und nicht mehr die großen industriellen Felder, wie wir es im Moment haben. Vielen Dank, und wenn Fragen sind, stehe ich ja gerne zur Verfügung.
Okay, thank you very much. This was a really exciting talk, hearing from the German point of view and seeing this nice picture, that it makes sense, because several times agroforestry issues are, when we talk about them, we think that this has to do with tropical countries, and we are really pleased to that we are let's say have been understandable that this is a future for agriculture in the intensively managed landscape. So I will give the speech to our next speaker, Matthias Schickhofen, who is a conservationist, a book author and photographer. And he's very well known for his actions in the Carpathians, preserving the Ancient Forest there, the need of preserving this unique ecosystem. And he will speak about the integration of strict nature protection and small-scale agriculture in the Carpathians. So, Matthias, go on. Thank you very much.
So, always the same problem. I was muted. So, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be able to speak here. I need to share my screen right now. I hope it works. Can you see it?
Yes.
Are you seeing the right screen or the notice board? Okay. So, yes, I will be speaking about biodiversity-rich landscapes, and I will try to bridge the issue we had at the last event, the Carpathians and the old growth and primary forests, also with the discussion about agroforestry and peasant lands, because there is a bridge and there are possibilities to actually combine that. I will start a little bit with the context. Biodiversity-rich ecosystems are rare in Europe and they are vanishing. They are vanishing due to intensification. They are vanishing due to greed, to illegal exploitation. That's a widespread problem in some countries. And they are also vanishing because the protection systems do not work properly. And I will give you some examples a bit later. The biodiversity richness of landscapes correlates with the absence or the low degree of industrial exploitation of resources. So wherever you have industrialized hardcore forestry or agriculture, biodiversity is more or less gone. Here on the picture, you can see an example of a very beautiful peasant landscape in northern Austria. It's an exceptional landscape nobody knows, almost nobody
yes.
knows.
Nur ganz kurz, das sind die Referentenansicht.
Aha, okay, that's what I was afraid of. So sorry, I need to stop that. Okay. So, second try. So is this the right screen now?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Sorry for the confusion. I have two screens and this is always causing problems. Okay, so what you can see here is a very biodiversity-rich, beautiful cultural landscape in northern Austria. It was constructed by the peasants 400 or 500 years ago. And it's now a landscape full of terraces and stripes, and there's lots of bushes and trees, which means that there's a lot of habitats for all kinds of different species you will not find anymore in a industrialized agriculture landscape. So this landscape is of course also worth to be protected and preserved. Uh-huh. And now, okay, it's still tricking me. Yes, and another important aspect of the context is that we are running into a climate crisis. As you can see in this picture here, that parts of the forests, which have been planted in the last 100, 200 years, mainly coniferous monocultures, spruce monocultures, are collapsing because of the effects of climate. Of the climate crisis. It's kind of a combination of the failures of forestry and the emerging climate crisis. It makes management mistakes visible and leads to an increasing collapse of annexations. This is on the one hand bad for economy and it's bad for ecosystem services because the forest cover is just vanishing. On the other side, the removal of the monocultures. And if this land would be left over for natural regeneration, this also would create a high degree of biodiversity. In this picture, you can see how this is looking like. On the right side, you can see a natural forest, which is part of a forestry management of a monastery in Austria. And this forest here is not exploited. It's a reserve. And on the other side of the valley, on the left-hand side, you can see the monocultures, which are getting more and more brown and which are collapsing. So all these spruce and pine trees will be gone in a few years, most likely. This does not necessarily lead to learning effects, as we can see here. So it's still, forestry is looking like agriculture here. There's another problem, which is also important for the context, is that there's a rising demand for woody energy biomass. This is on the rise also because of subsidies. It's heavily subsidized in many countries. Wood biomass is considered to be climate neutral and kind of zero emission. It's used to greenwash coal power plants in UK, Denmark, and so on. And this leads to an increased stress, logging stress, also for nature forests. But it's important to stress that the cutting and burning of major forests is not climate neutral before 2050. So the CO2 will not be absorbed back. What you can see here is, this is in my home country here. It's a Natura 2000 site where a old growth forest was cut just a few weeks ago. You can see this is very old trees. They have no value and they will just be burned. So now I come to actually the example I would like to present you today. So considering all this context, we still have some landscapes in Europe, which are highly interesting because of their biodiversity and also because of their tradition. Many of these very valuable precious landscapes are located in the Carpathians, in particular in Romania. And we have there a mosaic of biodiversity-rich natural forests, partly in primary, in close vicinity also to settlements and to traditional villages, and to small-scale peasant lands. And this kind of mosaic, it's a perfect example of how an integration of human use of resources but also protection of biodiversity and ecosystem services could be looking like. This is just an overview about Romania. It shows locations of potential old growth and primary forests. So you can see there is a lot left. Estimations are about 500,000 hectare forests, which are really very biodiversity rich and have a high ecological value. And here you can see that these forests are how they're ending up. All these very old trees with little economic value are being burned or shredded for chipboards. But this is a problem we have in whole Europe, that the logging intensity is increasing in Scandinavia and in the Carpathians. And in the case of Romania, this led to a EU infringement procedure, which was launched last year in February, but it got stuck somehow. And I will just talk about that a little later because this is part of the problem. So this coming back to Romania, I would like to show you an example of Cernei Valley. That's a beautiful valley in the heart of the Domoklet Valley of Cernei National Park, which is also a UNESCO World Heritage Site. On the picture, you can see the little hamlet of Prizacina. In this landscape, you have a very interesting mosaic of low intensity agriculture, small scale agriculture, but on the other side also you can see up on these mountains and hills that you can see there's a very natural forest. It's partly even a primary forest. And this shows how strict protection of natural ecosystems and also low impact economic use could be integrated. This doesn't have to be contradictions. Here in the picture, it's Boișoara. That's a little village in Făgăraș Mountains in southern Romania. There are almost only a few elderly people left. All the young people have left for the big cities. So the depopulation and the aging of the rural settlements is also a big problem. And logging is often seen as the only economical option because there is money coming from the logging companies, from the sawmills, but the alternatives are not really developed. This is how the logic is looking like. It does not create sustainable jobs. It destroys biodiversity and also critical ecosystem functions, especially in the mountains. And also it liquidates the foundations, the potential foundations for tourism development, which would have a less severe impact on the landscape. So back in Chana Valley, these ancient rural landscapes are a mix of cultural and natural landscapes, and they are of exceptional beauty. So all people who have seen this valley there, they come back with shiny eyes and swear that they will go back one day. So this is a great opportunity to develop also low impact rural and natural tourism. This would also generate income and improve the standard of living in these local communities. The people there live mainly on subsistence basis, but they have almost no income. And in terms of, I don't know, diseases or sickness, this is really creating problems. So income from tourism would be very much appreciated and needed. The examples here, there are some little hamlets in Chana Valley, and they are part also of the national park. They are part of the UNESCO World Heritage Site. Uh-huh. Google made an interesting translation of heritage. It's not a geriatric site. So these hamlets are located in the buffer zone, and there has been a conflict between forest exploitation, which was actually emphasized by the Romanian State Forest, but also by the National Park Administration. They wanted to open these valleys for logging, build roads, but also on the other side, the conservation objectives of the protected area. You can see here the area of Prisacina, where this conflict occurred a few years ago. Rob Silva wanted to build roads and exploit the natural forests in this part of the national parks. Fortunately, there have been protests. There was a petition which was signed by many thousands of people, and this plan was stopped. So there is the opportunity now to actually try to develop a plan B to the logging logic and to develop this kind of natural tourism, which would be the alternative for timber exploitation and which could also help to develop this economies there. Yeah, you can see it's really of great beauty. You have a kind of a mosaic of this traditional peasant forest. So there was kind of low level timber extraction, single tree extraction, whatever needed the firewood or construction wood in the villages, but this was not industrial logging. There was never any larger clear cut. It nested in between. You still find also old growths and even primary forests there. And if this would be opened just with hiking trails for hiking tourism, this would be compatible also with the conservation objectives of the protected area. So there would not be any contradiction, and there would be an economic benefit. So this would be actually a win-win strategy. I just wonder why it hasn't been done already. Yeah, there is almost no development into that direction. This would also help actually to create seasonal jobs and to hopefully bring back the young people, which are hardly missing because these villages are getting more and more empty. So as conclusion, both the natural ecosystems and the traditional smallholder agricultural landscapes need to be preserved. And we need to exploit all the legal means and economic incentives, subsidies, whatever, to make that happen. This needs to be one important part also of the biodiversity strategy and of the official programs of the European Union. So therefore, coming back to my main work, I'm working with Euronature on the protection of the old growth and primary forests in Romania. The infringement procedure in Romania must go on. Romania is not on the right track now, and this will be a test case whether the biodiversity strategy has a chance to be implemented or whether it will fail. Because if in this stronghold of nature in Romania, implementation of the biodiversity strategy will not happen, then it will also fail in the rest of Europe. Yeah. So the European Commission must not allow the infringement procedure to be concluded just based on some minor legal adjustments, because that's what Romania is proposing currently. Yeah, they want to comply, increase the compliance with the nature directives and the environmental impact, strategic environmental impact directive, and so on. But at the moment, there's no plan to do any intervention with the current logging plans, so with the actual forest management plans which are in place. So if this would not be stopped, logging would go on for another 10 years in many locations, and Europe would just stand by and watch how these forests are disappearing. So this must not happen. So therefore, I very much hope that the Commission will do the next step and also bring this case to the Court of Justice of the European Union. Yeah, that's the value of Boia Mica. We managed to get it under protection, 1,000 hectares of virgin forest, and local communities a little bit downstream in the lower parts of the valley, and they would benefit greatly from careful, cautious nature tourism development. So, and this is probably one of the pilot projects which could be developed in the next years. Thank you.
So, okay, thank you very much. And I really appreciate these nice, fantastic pictures of yours, which remind us, of course, some similar landscapes, of course, in the northern part of Greece, which face exact the similar problems of land abandonment that lead the local people, already depopulated areas, but mainly there remains the people that remain there are very old, and they do not have any other income, and they go to log all these ancient forests. Yeah. Or this is a huge problem, I think, in all over Balkans. But I'm very happy and very pleased to see corners of our common land, let's say Europe, to being preserved, although outside of the main economic, let's say, highway. So it's really important to see the preservation of these ancient landscapes, both within forest, but also in agroforest landscapes. So I will give the speech to Michalis Vrachnakis, who is a professor of the Department of Forestry and Wood Science and Design in the University of Thessaly, Karditsa, Greece. And he will speak about this agroforestry Mediterranean landscapes and the need to revitalize these traditional Silvo-Arab landscapes in order to be beneficial for the local economy, but also for the biodiversity and all these issues that we raised already. So, Michalis, you can go on. Thank you very much for being with us.
Okay, thank you, Rigas. Good evening, everybody. I would like to thank also, apart from Rigas, for introducing me. I would like also thank Klaus for organizing the webinar, and Jeff and Freda for supporting me. I will share my screen now. Yes. Well, as Rigas told before, I will present you the traditional Silvo-Arab landscapes in the Mediterranean, and I will focus on the need to revitalize them. I hope at the end of the day that the Mediterranean traditional agroforestry systems, it will be evident that they serve as values from the past and models for the future. This is an expectation for me, for my part. Well, agroforestry is a rural activity that refers to sustainable land management systems where the tree species are associated with herbaceous plants with some form of spatial arrangement or time sequence. These systems can also be grazed by farm animals, and this, in this respect, we can distinguish three such systems: the silvopastoral, agro-silvopastoral, and silvo-arable systems. But what about traditional agroforestry systems? These systems created by man in the past and are preserved to this day. Their creation is linked to the achievement of economic, environmental, and social goals. According to Professor Papanastasis, they have high cultural value that reflects the ways in which man lived in the past close to nature, faced and exploited the available natural resources, interacted with the environment and incorporated the natural elements and mostly the trees into his, her life. Martin talked before about the environmental benefits that we can acquire from agroforestry systems. So environmental benefits are mostly modification of the microclimate. It is positively affecting the population and diversity of insects and adjustment of water and nutrients in a general framework. Economic benefits are also quite important that we acquire from traditional agroforestry systems like timber, firewood, charcoal, piles, and non-wood forest products. When we incorporate it in our systems, fruit or truffle bearing trees. But the most important, maybe the most important, is the social benefits that we get from the traditional agroforestry systems. Such benefits, such social benefits, are referred to social cohesion and connectivity. They support a variety of rural development resources, urge farmers to make sustainable land use practices, ensuring of human health, infrastructure, alternative food supply, and mitigation of adverse effects on the environment, improve job creation opportunities, improve also public opinion on agricultural and forestry activities, create healthy environments, improve the landscape, while preserving the traditional agroforestry systems, the cultural value of a rural landscape is enhanced. Agroforestry is a rural activity that came from the prehistoric times. The early stages of agricultural activity in Europe included the interplay of agricultural and forest exploitation. The end of the Neolithic period and the beginning of the Bronze Age, the forests in Europe were open, like savanna type. You can see some representations on the right. Later, when the woodcuts were stabilized, some trees were preserved or others were planted for fruit production, etc. Traditional agroforestry systems were present in all historic times. Here's a representation of the landscape of the surroundings of ancient Olympia, and you can see in Greece and in all Greece, in ancient Greece, and we can see here the integration of trees inside the landscape. Also in Roman times, we can see the landscape, how it was represented in this picture. It is the case of Liguria in Italy. In Byzantine times, traditional agroforestry systems were active during Byzantine times. In Renaissance, here is a landscape that still exists in Tuscany, where you can see elements of this of the traditional agroforestry systems. And now we are coming to nowadays, talk about the traditional agroforestry systems. I will show you some examples from the Mediterranean countries, some traditional such systems, like for example, in France, there are the préverzés, grazing orchards, but in the south of France, they can also include crops, olive trees and walnut trees. Also in this agroforestry system, it is very famous also for ecotouristic activities. In Spain, there is a peculiar type of agroforestry system that it is traditional. It is called pomarada, and it was found in Asturias. Here in the upper story, we can find apples, pears, plums, cherries, figs, walnuts, and the ground crop, it could be cereals, corn, sorghum, and several other crops. In Spain and Portugal, of course, it is well known, dehesas and mondados, that they are very famous in all over the world about their peculiarities, about the production and the support they provide to the rural economies of this country. Here you see where is these systems are located in the Iberian Peninsula. It is mostly found on the south of this peninsula. Also, in Spain and Portugal, in the dehesas and mondados, we can say something about the silvopastoral systems that integrate quercus suber, that produce cork, which is very important for as a product that sustains the rural economy of Portugal, mostly of Portugal, but also in Spain. In Italy, we can say something about seminativo or pascolo arborato, deciduous-oak silvopastoral systems, occasionally combined with crops. In Italy, there are these fantastic systems that are traditional and still active. They are called piantata and juale. Piantata, actually, they are fruit orchards, silvoarable systems that incorporated with vineyards and poplars. Piantata is called in northern Italy, and olives, juale, which is called in southern Italy. It's common. In Greece, the traditional agroforestry systems are quite often represented in these fantastic paintings of 19th century that show us the increased, the high cultural values for nowadays, but also they represent that these systems were parts of the rural landscape of countryside of that times. Yeah, in Greece, we can, now that it is active, the most important, most famous, it is the Valonia oak silvopastoral system that Anastasia will present you more later in her presentation. We have some peculiar other systems like pollarded morus trees for silkworms. Here you see also women working for producing silk, mostly in the northeast of Greece. Olive orchards, in Amphisa, in Rovies, in Epidavros, they are often combined livestock grazing, that's the story. Also, in Lesbos Island, you can find olives on terraces, and also some peculiar systems that they integrate geese in the understory, or even chicken. Resin collection from pines, pine silvopastoral systems, you can find Aleppo pine, mostly Aleppo pine, you can find in several places of Greece, but still active. Also honey pines that produce famous honey from pines. It is another such system. Now, after this journey to some examples of traditional agroforestry systems, let's focus on the issues of degradation of Mediterranean systems. According to my opinion, there are three major drivers that lead to the increase the extinction risk of this system. The first is the land abandonment. Land abandonment, there is a projection of abandonment land in Mediterranean countries by 2030 that says that in the European Union, it is expected that up to 2030, more than 5.6 million thousands of hectares will be abandoned. A significant part of this is part of the Mediterranean countries, as you see here in this table. Look this picture from the Google Earth. It is a village here in Greece. It is in the center of Greece. It's called Batsunia. It is found in elevation of 408 meters, and the population is 450 inhabitants. And here you see the wrinkled landscape, which is formed in the surroundings of the village. These wrinkles are made the hedgerows. And here you see the hedgerows, the abandonment effect on the hedgerows. Also here, it is the same village, and you see how this geometrical, let's say, openings are starting to close gradually because of the abandonment. And here is in an upper level, you can see such wrinkled landscapes that gradually has lose its breakdown formation, and the landscape is becoming more homogenized. Another force increasing the extinction risk of the traditional agroforestry systems is land reparceling and conversion into monocultures. Here is an example of a remnant of this remaining bigger silvopastoral system that is still active in Kedros in Karvitsa in this village, and you can see how is the surrounding the conversion of this type of agroforestry into monocultures. It is pity that, that this landscape has this kind of form, which is not so, according to my opinion, which is not so environmentally healthy. Also, another reason for increasing the extinction risk is the illegal wood cutting of old trees. Here is an example, a sad example from Lesbos Island in Greece, that these trees were chopped to provide firewood during the economic crisis for the local people. So let's speak a little about modern agroforestry and the CAP and how rural development programs included agroforestry measure in Mediterranean countries. Portugal, Spain, and France were included this measure and activate this measure and implement this measure from the very beginning of the appearance of agroforestry in the CAP. In Italy, the first period was not implemented because there was not so, the farmers were not so aware about this measure, but then the rest periods, they implement the measure, the agroforestry measure. But in Greece, no. Unfortunately, no. My country never applied this measure. It's a pity, but never. In the first period, in the period of 2007-2013, the money, the funding for the implementation of the measure were moved, channelized to deal with the catastrophic effects that we have due to wildfires in Greece. And the next period, it was economic crisis, and the money and the funding were moved to another to other measures. But this is about modern agroforestry, but no inclusion of TAFs. It means that even the agroforestry measure that still exists and support modern agroforestry, this measure, unfortunately, still does not support the inclusion, that does not support the traditional agroforestry systems in Europe. To cope with degradation of traditional agroforestry systems, there are some possible solutions, according to my perception. First of all, is to make an intensive inventory program to inventory all the traditional agroforestry systems that they are all in Europe, not only Mediterranean, but also in Europe. Another possible solution is to include traditional agroforestry systems into CAP eco-schemes. Also, CAP must provide traditional agroforestry systems related provisions, and these provisions must be translated into member states' rural development programs. CAP must also focus mostly, according to my perception, must move its central focus to include also land abandonment issues. Another solution could be the land abandonment management plans, which is, according to my opinion, is very important to trace and find the problems of abandonment and to deal with them in a very comprehensive way. I'm writing here also 3 billion question marks because we, as Mark said before, and we all know, and all of us, we are aware that 3 billion trees will be planted in Europe, but where? This is the problem, where these trees will be planted, and maybe some of them could be planted in traditional agroforestry systems to revitalize them. And finally, promotion of special traditional agroforest products in the market, which is another important solution that will support traditional agroforestry in our countries. And some mild derivations of low cost are additionally proposed, like regular pruning of trees, thinning of trees, planting extra trees, and educational promotion of agroforestry and especially traditional agroforestry systems in the social structures. Thank you very much. And this is the link for URAF. URAF is the European Agroforestry Federation, and there someone can find very important information about agroforestry nowadays and traditional also agroforestry. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michalis, for the very interesting and great presentation. You travel all across so many countries, showing us so many examples. But also, I have to point out that you press also the cultural button and the importance of the cultural landscapes, which is several times ignored. So thank you very much again for the 3 billion question marks you placed. And I want to say that because Matthias Schickhofen has to leave at 7:30, would be could you please, Matthias, ask answer in a question that has been made to you, especially before leaving, that has to do with agroforestry systems and how what else can be done except of the tourism, or if this the tourism is the only proposal that we have to revitalize these unique abandoned landscapes.
Okay. My video is switched off. Could you please switch it on? Ah, okay. Now I'm back. Okay. I sent the written answer already. Of course, tourism is not the only option to improve the situation in these peripheric regions. Of course, there's also the option to develop direct marketing, whatever options of agricultural products, specialties, handicraft stuff. There are lots of initiatives all over Europe which could serve also as models. I come from an area where organic farming has been started by a small number of farmers in the north of Austria. And now in this region, a quite significant proportion of farmers are organic farmers, and they also produce specialties they can sell for a better price in the region, but also in special shops in the urban areas. And this also helps to get more economic development and welfare also in these peripheries. Yeah. So I think there are much more options, and there's lots of literature around how to develop rural areas. I think the tourism is especially interesting when it comes to areas which are of great natural beauty or where the natural values are very high, like areas in the Carpathians where you have primary no-growth forests, which could be in particular interesting for tourists and for hikers, which is not the case in all the agriculture landscapes in Europe. I hope this was somehow sufficient. And then there was the question about measures and subsidies and so on. Maybe Martin, maybe you can say something about that. I think LIDA and similar problems also provide funds for especially this kind of projects.
I think it's okay now. I don't know if Martin wants to make a small point now or after Mrs. Anastasia Bandera, who will speak about who is the next speaker. And she is a professor of the Department of Forest and Natural Environment in of the Agricultural University of Athens, and she will speak about silvopastoral activities, and especially about this system in the time, some examples and the work of the science community on them. So it's up to you. If Martin wants to make a small point now, it's open, but I would prefer to have everything all together in the end of the first round. Okay, Martin. Okay, so I give then the floor to Anastasia Bandera. Thank you very much being with us, and we are opening our eyes and our ears to hear about your interesting presentation.
Thank you very much, Rigas. It is great to be here. Let me start my presentation. It starts from the end. Okay, sorry. So it is really great to be here and share my thoughts and my results with you. And of course, my concerns mostly. And so it's really great to be among people that they really think or care about agroforestry and especially silvopastoral systems. So anyway, as I said, I try to be as confined as possible, especially in the the silvopastoral systems. So I would be more than happy. Can you see my presentation? Is everything okay?
Yes.
Now? Okay.
Yes. Just okay. Stop the because before it runs all the only one once. So okay.
I'm going to try to be short, but not that short. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. So I'm pretty sure that you have heard so many times about the definitions about agroforestry. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time just to point out the keywords. For me, it's quite important to stay on the keywords. So here are a couple of quite popular definitions of agroforestry. So what I would like you to focus is on the words in red. So what is agroforestry? It's land use, trees, crops, livestock, same area, spatial or temporal arrangements. In AgForward, in the project that I have been working, I was happy to be there, part of AgForward. So we also have more or less concluded to a definition, woody vegetation, crop, livestock, ecological, economic interactions. Again, keywords. So another definition, which actually lately I'm hearing a lot about, you know, the concerns about the farm to fork and all the EU policies. And the bottom line is what we're looking for is we're looking to maximum output to minimum entrance. So I think agroforestry is the answer to that. Agroforestry is the land use practice that is actually more or less by default is trying to take full advantage of the natural resources, respecting the natural resources, and try actually to take the mostly out of it. So how old is it? It is very old. And I'm talking about silvopastoral systems, of course. So based on Leuru, has been very, very old, especially in the Mediterranean region. And I'm going to place some emphasis, not all my emphasis to the Mediterranean regions, because it is a specific part of the world that, as you know, as everybody knows, has been not so much affected by the ice age. So it has been a very traditional, a very old practice. And so in time has been really included livestock in the natural environment. It has been incorporated within the system. And as Michalis Brachnakis showed, there are paintings that actually present livestock silvopastoral systems in time, and especially in Roman. But also, if you read the Odyssey from Homer, you can also read the description of some traditional agroforestry and silvopastoral systems. So it is quite old. How old? That old. Through dinosaurs, take into account that actually silvopastoral systems are the systems that actually livestock graze in the forest. So maybe we can say that, but well, no, this was just a funny picture that I thought it would be really lighten up my presentation, because what is missing from this point is the human component. So yeah. Agroforestry systems are traditional systems. And of course, it's an excellent combination of humans, natural resources, and livestock. there are throughout. I think that the Mediterranean is an excellent example. It's an agroforestry system by default. So here you can see a very typical example of an agroforestry system, which is the oasis. This is a picture from Tunisia. And actually, usually people there, after the end of the grazing of the cropping system, they usually use on the other ground, they use henna. And so at the end of the cropping system, they introduce their livestock to clear up the land. So this is an excellent example. I have a great admiration of these people, that they take a full advantage of the natural resources, of course, respecting the natural resources. Here you can see also many examples from that we have studied in the Ag Forward project. And so this picture here, can you see also while I move the mouse, Rigas? Is it possible? Okay. So here you can see a picture from Spain, which is actually from Galicia. And there they have this chestnut forest. And here are the famous black Iberian pig graze. So, and okay, so there is a market for these chestnuts, but the point is that at the end, in areas that they're not available for people to go and collect the chestnuts, usually these are the ones that they have been used for the pig grazing. And another typical example of livestock grazing is down here, which is from Italy. And it is actually these are some olive groves, and which based on the results we had from the Gut Forward project, it was perfectly actually being used afterwards by chicken. So, and here's another example from France. I'm going to show you this example again. So anyway, the point is that we have some very, very nice examples from the use of silvopastoral systems. So anyway, what are the silvopastoral systems by definition? Based on the more recent classification by Maria Rosa Mosquera, and that have been widely adopted, actually not, but by PK Nair and not other researchers working on agroforestry. So we have these more or less major types of agroforestry. The two most popular ones are the silvo-arable, the ones that also Vrahnakis Michalis has presented and other researchers, and silvopasture. So what is silvopasture? It's the combination of trees with forage and animal production. So it is in a forest or a woodland grazed or an open forest trees. Of course, there are other type of classifications in agroforestry. I'm just showing this. And if someone wants to have more information, they can always read this the article from Michael Dunherden. So it was also from the Ag Forward project. So more or less, silvopastoral systems are traditional agroforestry systems. And the key words that I have said before are the livestock that we actually, it's producing, it's giving a wide actually number of products, and which is nicely integrated with trees and shrubs. So it is actually it's not so easy. Some might say, okay, so if this is silvopastoral systems, I can always go and create one or make one. And this is actually one of the criticisms that there is on silvopastoralism. I'm going to talk about a little bit further on that, because people say that, oh no, as Martin has said, there's a difference between Northern Europe and Southern Europe. Okay, so silvopastoralism is actually defined by a combination of the species, of the climate, of the system, and the ownership. So it's not just one and one makes two. As I tell my students, when we are more or less a biological science. So in this science, one and one does not always equal to two. sometimes equals to zero and sometimes equals to 10. So actually, when you design, and someone wants to design a silvopastoral system, they have he or she has to take into account a lot of factors. And so the silvopastoral systems are very generous in providing a lot of products. And like timber, fuel, wood, anything that you can name, all the goods that actually trees provide. They have a lot of function, and this is what makes them so important, because they have a lot of functions that they're very important, especially lately due to the climate change, like water economy, like nitrogen, like inputs that I have said at the beginning, like shading and wind breaks, which is quite also important, especially because of the climate change. And of course, erosion control, and not mentioning also the boundary markers. And the animals, they are so important for pastoral systems, because they provide all these goods, like whatever it's quite obvious, like dairy products, milk and cheese and everything. But they also do many, many other good things. What? They actually enhance organic matter turnover and nutrient transfer. They remove the sprouts. They actually increase soil organic matter. And I think that's what's quite really important lately, is that they reduce the understory biomass and subsequently reduce forest fire risk. Actually, we have done a work last year, and it was quite interesting because we have used GIS and other interesting modern tools, and we have more or less seen that in agroforestry systems, we have less forest fire incidents. So this is a major issue, especially lately because of the forest fires problems. Of course, as I said before, in biological sciences, like in agroforestry, in forestry, in agriculture, of course, one and one does not always equals to two. So of course we have problems. And what's the problem? The problem is that the animals may damage the regeneration and the trees. But this is what is management for. It's not like we're just gonna introduce the animals, the livestock, and then go. Of course, everything needs to be attended, and of course, and the management needs to be done. So, for example, in Greece, we have several silvopastoral systems. These are divided to the open forest. These are traditional ones with canopy less than 40% and grazable forest, that tree canopy is more than 40%. And again, this one plus one does not equal two example, because some people say, and some colleagues also say that, okay, are you suggesting that we graze the forest? Okay, if we can, yes, of course, if we can, not if we cannot. For example, after regeneration or any other type of treatment, or the area or the soil is eroded or is prone to erosion, then no, we cannot graze there. We can only graze when we can. And this is what the management is for. So in Greece, and also not only Greece, in Mediterranean actually area, we have some different husbandry types. We have the village or the flock system. So we have the movement of animals from the upper altitude to the lower altitude. And actually this was so nice, and it was enhancing so much the biodiversity and everything. And these are the husbandry times that they're getting less and less interest lately. And I think this is something that really needs to be preserved. So, and take into account that Mediterranean is also the meeting point of three different continents. And that means that you have all these different species. So this luxury, this great biodiversity and great presence of different species that really needs to be preserved. So silvopastoral systems, as I said, give a lot of advantages. And I think that these are actually the advantages that they have so much more importance lately because of this climate change. So you use a lot of space, you protect the biodiversity. you enhance soil properties. You increase, of course, production because the stakeholder, the farmer, can have more income out of his land. And as I said, the what's really important, lower forest fire risks. Of course, as I said, we have some disadvantages, but as I also said, this is what is management for. In management, you have to take into account these problems and deal with them. So lately, the agroforestry systems are facing some problems. What are the problems? The problems is in most of the cases that they people are not so much into grazing. Young people are not so much into grazing. Sometimes they feel embarrassed if to admit that they are shepherds. And they prefer to do some other type of jobs that they are more fancy and they hear better to the ear, like even work on the tourist industry. And so this is one of the major problems of silvopastoral system. So also to climate change, we have a lot of problems. And so this is the land use changes. Sorry, but I was also in another meeting today and I was talking all day. So, Riga, 1 minute, please.
Okay, take a minute break. Okay. And we have to know, there are some questions in the Q&A chat room, but you can add more, but please do it directly to whom you want to be answered so that I can easily spread the message to each of the speakers and to combine probably some questions. Thank you very much. Anastasia, is okay? Okay. Don't press yourselves. Thank you very much.
It is the fourth presentation of the day, so.
Okay, we understand.
Thank you. Okay, so anyway, and I was given the opportunity lately to also look about the effect of agroforestry system to climate change in specific. So I think that agroforestry is a threatened lately in silvopastoral systems, of course, because of the land use changes. Actually, we have also done a work last year and we have evaluated the land use changes in silvopastoral systems in Greece. I'm gonna show some pictures afterwards. And it was really amazing. It is quite obvious because farmers prefer to abandon the silvopastoral systems and use their land for other more typical systems like olive groves. So we have this agricultural abandonment, which is quite affecting mostly specifically the mountainous regions. And actually was surprised because I thought that it was a problem of Greece. But as I said, I took a glance on the literature and I discovered that this is a common problem, not only to Greece, but to most Mediterranean countries. For example, I was reading an article from Morocco and they have the same problems there. I was discussing with some colleagues from Turkey and they said exactly the same problem. So it is a common problem. And I think, I hope that this will be also something to deal with from the policymakers. And I'm very happy that we have some today. So maybe they're gonna get some ideas. So, and Martin, you mentioned a new terminology, new normal. I love this terminology. I'm going to introduce another terminology of my own. Knowledge flexibility, which means what? Who wants to listen to something new or hear it? We have organized many stakeholder meetings and it was quite obvious that we were telling the same things to people and some were listening and some were not. So the adoption of the knowledge was quite different among people. So this knowledge flexibility, it's quite important, because no matter what we say, no matter what we do, if people do not want to listen, then it's for vain. So if we want to save the silvopastoral systems, if we want to save the agroforestry system, people have also to be ready to adopt this new or old systems and knowledge. So, for example, here is a picture from one of our experiments in the island of Kea, Zia. It's in the Aegean. And here you can see an abandoned before silvopastoral systems. And the farmer, the father of the farmer, he used to, in the old time, he used to use this area to produce crop to feed his animals. So this hasn't been practiced for many years. So when we were there, when we talked about and we gave them the idea of silvopastoralism, and two farmers were quite interested on applying it. So you can see out of the 20 or 30 farmers, two were the ones that had the knowledge flexibility to hear, listen. They were very excited, and actually they were very ready to adopt these new / traditional practice. So as you can see here, he did it. He practiced it. These are the outcomes. Here you can see these are Valonia oak, Quercus tamburensis of Swiss macrolepsis. And here is the crop that he's going to use to feed his animals, his livestock. And here also you can see some pictures from Greece, and here also the problems. Actually, this is a picture of the problems. Here on the top, you can see an ex silvopastoral system of Avalonia oak, and now the locals are actually cutting down the trees and they're converting it to olive groves. Here it's also another picture from another side of the same forest of this Avalonia oak. And here you can see that on the flat line, the farmers preferred to cut the trees and make it to turn it to agricultural intensive culture. Another problem of the silvopastoral system is actually, so you have to, we have to the two extremes. We have the abandonment and we have the overgrazing in some cases. In this case also here, you can see the abandonment. So here the farmers prefer to, they have left because it's not easily accessible because for some reason. So we have this understory vegetation, we have the foreign, in some cases, some other species invading. So more or less, we have problems of regeneration, and we have been working for the past 7 years in the same, in this specific area. And we are trying to find the answer why there is such a low regeneration in the silvopastoral systems. Here is another picture of the same forest, and you can see some goat grazing the trees. Some people say that they are not really so happy with the goats. Well, no, I'm not. This is a part of the landscape. Goats have been there, have been grazing. They have been forever. I wouldn't dare to say I take the goats out of there. What I would dare though to say is if somebody has concerns about the grazing, goat grazing, then they should actually apply management. So you cannot just leave the animals, the livestock and leave. You have to be there, you have to take care of the livestock, and you have to lead the livestock. This is what shepherds are for. So, and other problems of the silvopastoral systems is that you can see also here on the back, this is another silvopastoral system, the oak from Greece. And they have cut down the trees and they have turned them to solar panel systems. Okay, so overgrazing in some cases, so loss of soil, abandonment on the top. Here is another beautiful picture of this great silvopastoral system. It actually, I should say that it's one of the last unique silvopastoral systems in the Balkan. So this needs to be preserved. This is the picture actually also. It's a very nice, it's a very Mediterranean and traditional landscape. And I should mention at this point that this forest was preserved, the silvopastoral system was preserved because of the acorns. You can see on the lower picture that it has been a great trading in the past for the acorns and for the cups. Lately, there has been some efforts to revive this traditional practice, but again, people are not so, as I said, flexible. They're not willing. There is no willingness to listen to these past / new traditional systems. And these are some other pictures from silvopastoral systems. And also, I think that these are pictures really the Mediterranean landscape. It's not Greece, it could be Turkey, it could be Italy, it could be Morocco, it could be France, it could be Spain. This is a Mediterranean silvopastoral system. So, because we have to realize that the livestock is part of the system. It's part of the landscape. It's part of the tradition. It's part of our history. So just to show you how much these silvopastoral systems are important. They are concerning our tradition and natural environment. Actually, here are a few numbers that I have collected from previous research. So you can see in the of the whole agricultural area. Of the era, you see in Greece, you have a lot area. The same with Cyprus, you have some public owned forest. The vegetation with coniferous forest and everything. And also from Turkey, you have also this oak forest from Turkey, from Quercus. And Israel also, we have the same Quercus taburensis forest, the tabor oak, as they say. So anyway, the good news concerning the silvopastoral system is that there's a growing interest lately due to the environmental awareness. And they have to be included in this reforestation and also research projects. They can provide many products, actually. They provide even black turfers, for example. I mean, there are so many reasons to protect this forest so we have to advertise these products if we want to save them. And so we have to, as I said, I think it's quite important to get in contact with the local people. If you want to save something, if you want to preserve something, you have to make it in accordance, in collaboration and cooperation with the locals, the farmers. If they don't want to be involved, then I think that you have a lost cause there. And of course, we have to make an evaluation of the ecosystem services. So this is why I think I have placed in my presentation the importance of the educational projects. One project that we have worked on was the AgroFMM. It was an Erasmus project. And I think through this project, we have been given the opportunity to get in contact with many farmers and present the systems. And I think that we did some good for this. For example, another one was relevant training-based activity was in Hungary. And another Erasmus project, which is called Climate Change, is running right now. You can find it also on YouTube. There have been quite a lot of presentations concerning agroforestry and silvopastoral systems, of course.
Anastasia, could yes? you please sum up? Opportunity to say more during the Q&A section. Thank you.
Okay. And of course. And actually, these are the examples. So here, the forward project, you can find if somebody wants to have more information of the silvopastoral or agroforestry system in general, you can find a lot of information. And just to conclude, I would like to point here, this is an experiment we had on silvopastoral systems. It was the same rationale. It was a silvopastoral systems in Northern Ireland, here's Northern Ireland, in England, and in France, same components, apple trees with sheep. Very successful in France, not successful at all in Northern Ireland. Meaning what? Management. You need the management. You have to take into account. You have to know. So if someone wants to have more information, we have the innovation leaflets that we have produced through like forward projects. So you can take a look at them. Also in the AFINET projects, a lot of leaflets and lots of information that anybody can use. As also Michalis said, we have the European Agroforestry Federation, where somebody who would like to have more information on agroforestry, he can go to. So you can see we have many information there as well in Europe. And in Greece also, we have the Hellenic Agroforestry Network. So there are many, many associations and many, many locations that people can actually go in for information. So to conclude, for me, sound management is urgently needed to support and preserve them as part of our natural environmental heritage. So thank you very much. And I hope I didn't take a lot of time. Brigas.
Okay, thank you very much, Anastasia. I have to give very pleased to have Martin here, and I give him the floor because he has to leave in 8 minutes. So please, Martin, you have also already 3 questions in the Q&A, so go on.
Ja, kann ich gerne machen. Ich muss leider auch um 8 Uhr in die nächste Veranstaltung. Ja, nur ganz kurz zu dem, was gesagt wurde. Ich fand das wirklich alles sehr interessant. Und ich möchte noch mal verdeutlichen, es geht nicht nur sozusagen um Südeuropa. Wir haben auch in Mitteleuropa, auch in Deutschland traditionelle Systeme gehabt, die in den letzten Jahren verschwunden sind. Zum Beispiel in Baden-Württemberg. Und auch bei uns, kleinbäuerliche Gegend, war um jedes Dorf eine riesen Obstbaumplantage, alte Obstbäume und auch inzwischen an Wegerändern waren immer Obstbäume gepflanzt. Die sind alle in den letzten Jahren verschwunden. Warum? Weil es keine Nutzung mehr gab. Bei uns in Hessen gibt es traditionell ein Getränk, was schwer zu verköstigen ist, und zwar Apfelwein. Das trinken nur bestimmte harte Menschen. Aber das konsumiert keiner mehr. Ja? Und deshalb haben diese Bäume keinen Wert mehr. Man freut sich jetzt zwar noch, dass da Vögel drin sitzen, aber vor 20 Jahren hatte das keinen Wert mehr. Deshalb ist meine These, das gilt also auch für alle Regionen, wir müssen diese Landschaften, ich hoffe, ich bin jetzt noch zu hören, ja, wir müssen diese Landschaften,
yes, we hear you, yes.
Ja, okay. Diese Landschaften wieder in Wert setzen. Wir müssen sozusagen einen Nutzen wieder kreieren. Und das können wir mit verschiedenen Töpfen auch der Europäischen Union machen. Also ich habe vorhin viel über die erste Säule geredet, wo das jetzt möglich ist. Aber alle Mitgliedsländer und vor allem in Südeuropa haben die Mitgliedsländer eine zweite Säule, wo man genau solche Aktivitäten verknüpfen kann. Tourismus, regionale Verkostung, regionale Vermarktung kann man zum Beispiel über LEADER-Programme wunderbar mit anderen Akteuren sozusagen Projekte kreieren. Also es ist nicht immer nur der Bauer gefragt, sondern es ist die Region gefragt. Es sind auch die gefragt, der Handel, die verarbeitenden Gewerbe, die müssen mit ins Boot geholt werden, damit man sozusagen nicht nur eine Landschaft hat, an der man sich erfreuen kann, sondern dass die Menschen, die da sind, auch wieder Nutzen davon haben. Ansonsten erleben wir auch in diesen Regionen, die Bilder waren ja eben klar, eine Intensivierung. Ich habe das selber auch in Portugal gesehen, da werden halt diese Regionen, da wird massiv Eukalyptus angepflanzt, weil man mit diesen Eukalyptusbäumen, Portugal hat ja eine große Industrie, um Papierholz herzustellen, das wird halt dann mit Eukalyptus aufgeforstet und wir alle wissen, was das für Folgen hatte bei den Bränden in den letzten Jahren. Deshalb muss auch ein Interesse da sein, diese alten Systeme zu erhalten, weil die auch in vielen Ländern einen ganz erheblichen Beitrag dazu geleistet haben, etwas gegen Feuer zu unternehmen. Brach liegen gelassene Regionen oder Regionen, wo man Eukalyptus pflanzt, diese Regionen gehen als erstes in Flammen auf, wenn wirklich was passiert. Und dann kommen danach die Spekulanten. Deshalb müssen wir diese Regionen sozusagen über alle Förderprogramme mit reinnehmen. Und man muss diese Förderprogramme kombinieren. Wir haben jetzt für alle Mitgliedsländer einen riesen Recovery-Fonds. Es ist eure Aufgabe vor Ort sozusagen, dass eure Mitgliedsländer, dass Griechenland, dass andere Länder sozusagen diese Recovery-Fonds jetzt nicht nur ausgeben für Technologien, sondern dass die auch genutzt werden können. Und ein Großteil geht ja auch in die zweite Säule für die Entwicklung ländlicher Räume. Weil ein Punkt ist ja von allen gesagt worden, die jungen Leute wandern ab. Und das ist ein Riesenproblem. Und das hat auch viel damit zu tun, dass das in vielen Regionen keine Arbeit ist, die man da leistet, die einfach ist, sondern sie ist anstrengend. Sie hat generiert wenig Einkommen. Und deshalb muss man gucken, wie kann man auch in diese Regionen wieder Einkommen hinbekommen. Nicht nur, dass sich dann Touristen von außen dran freuen, sondern wie kann man Tourismus in Verbindung mit einer herkömmlichen Landwirtschaft in Wert setzen? Wie kann man zum Beispiel dann auch Obstbau, jedenfalls ist das eine Sache, die bei uns in Baden-Württemberg gut läuft, da werden zum Beispiel diese alten Obstbestände genommen, um wieder Schnaps zu brennen. Ja? Ein Punkt, der in vielen Regionen tatsächlich für den Tourismus einen enormen Boom hervorgerufen hat. Und so macht man zwei Sachen. Man tut was für die Biodiversität, man gibt eine Nutzung für die alten Obstbäume und man hat sozusagen eine Wertschätzung für die Region, weil man plötzlich eine Marke hat, mit der die Region sich identifiziert. Es ist gefragt worden nach Irland. Ja, man kann eigentlich in jedem Land solche Systeme, die man hat, wo kombiniert wurde zwischen Wald oder Hecken und Landwirtschaft, diese muss man fördern. Und natürlich auch in Norddeutschland gab es und gibt es diese Systeme mit Hecken rund um jedes Flurstück, damit die nicht austrocknen, damit halt auch Nutzen da ist für Holz. Und deshalb muss man auch das sozusagen fördern. Aber wie gesagt, es liegt nicht daran, dass es zu wenig Mittel gibt. Diese Mittel sind da, auch mit relativ hohen Finanzierungen aus Brüssel, mit wenig Kofinanzierung. Was meistens fehlt, sind vor Ort die Akteure und, ich sage es auch mal ganz ehrlich, der Wille von vielen Regierungen, sich damit intensiv zu beschäftigen. Man konzentriert sich lieber auf Industrieprojekte. Man schafft und meint, man mit Industrieansiedlung schafft man Arbeitsplätze. Und deshalb hat es zur Folge, nicht nur in Griechenland, nicht nur in Portugal, in vielen Regionen, nicht nur in Rumänien, dass diese Regionen abgehängt werden von einer Entwicklung und deshalb junge Leute abwandern in Industrieregionen oder sogar in andere Länder und suchen sich Jobs, wo sie Geld verdienen. Und ich glaube, das ist ein Trend, der ist wirklich fatal, weil, ich sage es nochmal, wenn wir diese ganzen alten Ressourcen verlieren, verlieren wir auch eine Menge Wissen. Die nächste Generation weiß gar nicht mehr, wie man das noch nutzt. Und ein zweiter Trend, wenn wir Kombinationsprojekte machen, ich habe das in Süditalien gesehen, da werden die alten Obstbäume, die alten Olivenbäume gefällt, zunehmend gefällt, weil sie kompliziert sind zu beernten. Und dann pflanzt man diese neuen Arten von Olivenbäumen, diese kleinen, maschinell erntbaren Olivenbäume, wo dann auch eine Landschaft sozusagen maschinengerecht hergerichtet wird. Und dasselbe ist auch im Obstbau, dass diese Kombination, die immer da war in der Landwirtschaft, Obstbau, Nutzung durch Schafe und Ziegen, dass das wegfällt, weil diese alten Obstflächen nicht mehr da sind, weil heute Obstbau, wer Südtirol kennt, weiß, wie der Obst angebaut wird, plötzlich solche völlig durchrationalisierten, sehr chemisch intensiven Anbausysteme überwiegen. Und da müssen wir von wegkommen. Und deshalb vielen, vielen Dank für die wirklich sehr interessanten Vorträge. Ich habe echt was gelernt, muss ich wirklich sagen, hat mich bereichert und ich bin gern bereit, dass wir da nochmal in die Thematik einsteigen und dass wir auch schauen, dass wir aus den GAP-Mitteln genügend Mittel freimachen können, sowohl für die zweite Säule, für solche Projekte, aber auch für andere regionale Projekte. Und wir müssen auch regionale Projekte der GAP kombinieren mit Regionen, mit regionalen Projekten, sagen wir, aus anderen Fonds kommen. Auch das ist halt wichtig, damit wir sagen, nicht eine Maßnahme so entwickeln und die nächste dagegen, sondern dass wir das alles kombinieren. Und am Ende müssen wir es schaffen, dass wir in diesen Regionen Bauern und Menschen in diesen Regionen eine Perspektive geben. Und da reicht meistens nicht nur eine Maßnahme, sondern da brauchen wir viele Maßnahmen, kluge Köpfe, kluge Ideen. Und das habe ich heute genügend von gesehen. Das bin ich also ganz hoffnungsfroh, dass wir das zumindest aufhalten können oder in eine andere Richtung drehen können. Vielen Dank.
Thank you very much, Martin. I'm really sorry that you have to leave, but again, it's very important that you raise the social part of this issue, and this is the rural depopulation. It's really a huge problem that has not been tackled, let's say, and it needs to many different resources that would make the rural living more attractive. Thank you very much, and I will go on with some small questions. We do not have so many, so I would say that Michalis Vrachnakis could probably answer the very, very nice question about the who has been posed by Mr. Emin Sotea, who has been in Karditsa also, and he is asking about the collaborative system of working the land and sharing things. So could you please make a comment on this, Michali?
Yeah, actually, I wrote the answer because I didn't know if I have enough time. But anyway, I will answer. Yes, of course, I would suggest such cooperative management. Men and women are part of the rural landscapes, and any intervention we like to have, we must include the human dimension. But to do so, it is quite important to raise the hesitation of farmers to adopt agroforestry as an activity that will significantly increase of their income in medium term. It's important, this point is very important. Because farmers are quite suspicious about the adoption of agroforestry. So it is an issue that we must overcome, to firstly overcome this issue and then to create such cooperative management. And the other part of the question was about the applied research. Yes, applied research has already showed the ecosystem benefits that agro-systems can provide to society. It is important so regional business to include in their portfolio all these activities that support the landscape regeneration and accordingly ecosystem service provision. It is very important. Yes, applied research has already given us answers on this. And it is up to regional authorities to create, to establish such initiatives, such regional business, and to include all these activities that support landscape regeneration. Thank you very much for the question. And I'm happy that you were at least once in Karditsa. I hope to see you in Karditsa again.
Okay, as I was also a speaker and I see some questions that could be answered by me, I would answer, could you please give me the 1-2 minutes to answer the question about biodiversity? And then an anonymous has also asked about how do we ensure the solution is a protective enhancement and not a degradation? And this is my answer will combine these two, but the case in Ireland and the case in Cork, which both the one with hedgerows and the other with the Asian native woodlands have been damaged because of some payments. I would say that biodiversity, because we live the two main crises this time of we are entering a very dark probably period, and we have to tackle both crises: the global biodiversity crisis and the global climate change. So both, we want both to do something for both of them. And I don't see any reforestation, afforestation, or planting that has not taken seriously in account the biodiversity crisis. If we are going to plant eucalyptus trees in flammable landscapes, we don't do really reforestation. We do silly things. We do things that we have been done again in the past and have been proved to be destructive for the natural environment. Biodiversity should be all over, horizontally, in all the pillars and all payments should be taken seriously in account. And this is so that because we have seen, especially in the Mediterranean, that agroforestry systems do not only support biodiversity, but they support a species unique for those agroforestry landscape, especially when they are, when, for example, ancient trees are within them. So biodiversity, we don't speak about reforestation or productive reforestation without speaking about the need for economically viable landscapes, either ancient or modern ones. And of course, biodiversity should be the thing that will judge if we want to go on with this or we don't. And especially this has to do also with the islands, where, for example, the terraces are collapsing because of payments, and we don't want to see that going on. This is the reason why we put also biodiversity in the title of our book, but also that we want to make this ancient landscape economically viable. So we have another two, three questions. Probably Pandera could make also a small note, and about, for example, the how we can proceed with these payments, and how we can in a national level do some things, because as Martin said, it's the countries that should take some responsibility of how they handle the money that are available.
Yeah, Rigas. Well, it is, as I said, it's a matter of policy. Michalis also said that, he pointed out. I mean, it's in Greece, we have been through also the Hellenic Agroforestry Network. We have done so many meetings, and we have been in contact with so many policymakers, and still we have not any response so far. We, of course, we do hope that something will change. But so I think for me, it's a matter of combination of also stakeholders asking for this money, and also for politicians willing to hear this or realizing the importance. Because it's quite obviously that not all the politicians are farmers or agronomists or foresters. And so sometimes it's not so obvious for them the importance and how critical it is to take some actions on that. So on the one side, we need to educate, we need to tell people that it's quite for their own interest to ask for support for their systems. And on the other hand, we also have to educate or inform the politicians about the critical situation we are right now. And they do need to take some actions, because it's not only for one term, it's not only for 1 year, it's not for 2 years, it's for the future. And I'm teaching forest soils, so in my first class, I always tell my students that it takes hundreds of years to make soil, but it takes only 5 minutes to destroy the soil. So we need to take some critical messages to everybody to understand that we are presently at a very critical point and we need to take some actions. So this is, I'm saying this because I haven't answered directly to your question, because it's not a straightforward answer. It is a spherical point, and it's not just one answer. You have to take a lot of actions to move forward. But again, of course, we need support, because I have been discussing with many livestock breeders also here in Karpenisi, in the mountains, Greece. And it is quite obvious that in some locations, such as here, the remote locations, it's not so easy for the livestock. It's easy for me to ask for the young people to stay and keep their flocks and continue grazing and do the shepherds, but it's not so easy for them to stay. And it's not also economic viable to stay and do some keep their farms. So we have to take this into account as well. I mean, as I said in my presentation, location, where we are, what are the needs, what are the problems, and I think also some of the previous speakers said that it's an equation. It's not a straightforward answer. It's an equation that needs to take a lot of parameters into account and take into and conclude to a viable solution and fair solution actually for everybody. So if we want to keep these practices, if we want to continue saving these practices, because also somebody said that it's quite important to keep this knowledge, to keep this wisdom. For me, it's a wisdom. And so if we want to take this wisdom, continue, and we have to inherit this wisdom to our children, we have to take into account also these people and how these people are and what the situation they are, and make this a viable solution.
Okay, I don't know if Dagmar from the organizing committee wants to make also a question, and then I have only another one for Michalis Vrahmakis. Thank you.
Thank you, Rikas, but just put your question and I will do some last summary, if you please. Thank you.
Okay, so Michalis, there is a question about from Yanis Kazoglou, and he said something which is also interesting. Sometimes we don't understand, probably in some member states, they don't understand how important and how valuable is the systems that are preserved by accident or not because of the political will. And he said, if agroforestry measures of Pillar 2 should somehow be imposed to member states. So what is your opinion about imposing some measures that probably local or national priorities are not taken in account?
Yeah, this is something that I have already think about it. Actually, this morning I was talking with a friend, with Kostas Manzanas, and I told him that, well, Kostas, I'm thinking that maybe a directive, a EU directive about agroforestry, maybe it is important to launch, because this way, probably the member states will be pressed to apply to promote agroforestry. But actually, I don't think that the directive is something very, very serious to say. But anyway, I don't know how to do it. Maybe the first step is to run some demonstration plants, some demonstration of the agroforestry in rural societies. And then if the people, the farmers, see that these systems provide values, then they press government. It is a bottom-up process, then maybe the governments will adopt.
Okay, thank you. And last question has been just came up, and this is an interesting one, and has to do with I want probably Pandera will be the one who can ask the answer this, and has to do with isolated pockets of Asian forest, and if we have, like in Ireland, the Andrew Ledger is asking for, but I know we have also in Greece, these isolated pockets of Asian forest, and how are these, if we have some examples that this agroforestry measure could do something for preserving and connecting this Asian forest, and if we have some examples of this in Europe or in Mediterranean or in Greece.
Okay, well, I just typed the link to the innovation leaflets of the AgForward project, and I think that there anybody can find a lot of information of examples that they are experimental results, which is quite important. It's not just like my opinion, whatever. So we have been working for 4 years within the AgForward project. So there many people can find, even because we had similar ancient forest in Romania also, as have been presented today. So there are many actually examples that people can read and take some examples and some ideas. And also there are also some emails of the people that they have been conducting the research. So if they need more information, they can go there. Yeah, for just one comment from myself. If we want to apply some management, we have to look around us, as I say. I mean, what have been traditionally been practiced there? So it's not like what I'm doing here in Greece, it's applicable in Ireland or in Romania, but I'm pretty sure that there has been some wisdom, some traditional practices, some traditional ways that people have been doing there. And I know because I have been in Ireland, I have visited Ireland, and the locals have presented us some traditional practices there. So I'm pretty sure that there are some answers there, but it's not that what I'm doing here in Greece is applicable in Ireland.
Thank you very much, Anastasia. Thank you very much for the answer. Yes, there are examples everywhere, but probably small projects, but there are examples. And we don't see the willingness, these examples, to expand. And I would say that even if NGOs, for example, or local people are pressing for the preservation of landscapes, for the cultural heritage, for the biodiversity, for the importance of tackling the desertification erosion problem, or the importance for honey production, or the importance of non-timber product production. All these stakeholders, if they combine, I would say, forces, then we will see probably policy making changing and towards this that we say multifunctional and multifunctional agroforestry, which is also the comment from attendee. So, Dagmar, we already have been late 20 minutes, and so do you want to end up this nice event, making a final comment?
Sehr herzlichen Dank, Rigas. Sehr herzlichen Dank euch allen. Ich kann an Martin anschließen. Ich habe heute Abend sehr, sehr viel gelernt. Und mir ist auch eines sehr präsent und bewusst, und das erfüllt mich trotz allem mit großer Zuversicht und Freude. Wenn wir über solche Themen sprechen, wenn wir über Klimawandel sprechen, dann kommen wir sehr rasch auf den Boden, und zwar auf unserem Boden, auf unsere Wurzeln. Es ist ganz, ganz wichtig, dass wir das Land schützen, auf dem und in dem wir leben. Und insofern, ja, jede Maßnahme, um unser Klima zu schützen, muss auch von einer sozialen Maßnahme flankiert oder begleitet werden. Auch das hat Martin angesprochen. Wir sprechen nicht zuletzt von einer sozial-ökologischen Transformation. Das alles muss auch immer im Hinblick auf die Lebensrealität der Menschen abgestimmt sein. Wir wollen alle ein gutes Leben und das bedeutet aber auch, dass wir von dem, was wir tun, tatsächlich leben können. Und ich glaube hier, so wie du das auch jetzt angesprochen hast, Rigas, ist es einfach notwendig, dass wir alle zusammenstehen und auch nicht locker lassen. Ja, es braucht jeden Einzelnen von uns, es braucht NGOs, die hier die Bürger und Bürgerinnen unterstützen und auch Druck machen auf die Politik. Die Politik ist gerne bequem, das wissen wir alle, und geht den leichtesten Weg oder auch den Weg des Geldes. Aber das ist nicht immer der Vorteil für uns alle. Und insofern ist es notwendig, Druck zu machen und einfach dran zu bleiben. Und was mir wahnsinnig gefallen hat, Anastasia, waren auch deine Beispiele. Es hat mich vieles erinnert an die kleinräumige Landwirtschaft hier bei uns in Mitteleuropa, in meiner Heimat in Österreich. Die Unterschiede sind nicht so groß. Und ich glaube, wenn wir alle am gleichen Strang ziehen, dann kommen wir auch einen Schritt weiter. Efferistopoli, Michalis, das waren ganz großartige Inputs von Ihnen. Hat mich wahnsinnig gefreut. Auch an Sie, Anastasia. Ja, bleibt mir nur noch zu sagen, ich hoffe und wir werden dieses Thema weiter lancieren und fortsetzen und ich hoffe, euch sehr bald entweder bei euch zu Hause in Griechenland besuchen zu können oder euch zu unserer Veranstaltung im Herbst hier einladen zu dürfen. Ja, adios, Sas, habt noch einen schönen Abend und weitermachen. Vielen Dank.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to thank also all the attendees that they posed these nice and interesting questions. I want also to say a big thank you to the organizing committee, also to Klaus Mers, who was in the backstage together with Andrian Dothu, who supported the whole project and the whole work, and to the other people that they make also the Greek English translation, and to all the organizing committee, and hope see you again in the next event, because probably we will present our book in Greek and in English, the book about reforestation, the productive reforestation, and the revival of the living rural landscapes with through agroforestry measures in the next probably meeting. We have no idea when, but surely we will come again on this interesting issue. Thank you very much for attending. Goodbye.
Goodbye.